sunshine.
In today's media industry, music and audio is a key component in helping films to direct a viewer's emotions, and in some cases, the music in a scene can really enhance the dramatic, comedic or even frightening effect. Movies today put a lot of effort into their sound and audio production, because music itself can really make or break a film's tone or its overall feel. Music started being used in films which were the so-called talking pictures, created in the 1920s, and these were simply 2D pictures which, when in order, they told a story that the audience could follow, and there have been many speculations as to why the infusion of music into these films happened. Some include that the music added a sort of depth to the 2D pictures which appeared on screen, and other benefits were that the music covered up the cacophony of noise that would spew from the projector. Most of the music which was played at a theatre for these kinds of pictures were typically played by full orchestras, organists or pianists. A lot of the films were accompanied by a book of music, which had categories for each piece of music, and these would be by mood, event or element. Many of these came with a suggestion list of what music should be played in what scene, and the first film to have its own music score was Birth of a Nation, which was made in 1915, and all the music was compiled only for that film. This was quite a different film at the time, not only for having its own soundtrack, but also for having innovative expression in cinematography and being a testimony of racism at the beginning of the 20th century. In the early 1930s, music was established as quite a vital element to talking pictures, and then to all films. So when companies started using sound in all their films, they would stick by their old ancestors' ways of already using compiled Western music or classical music, which had been all created during the 19th century. However, this soon faded away when people started to make their own music scores, and the first person to do this was Max Steiner, when he made the first completely original score for his film King Kong in 1933. Comedy duo had been growing in popularity from the late 1920s. They always made short films and sometimes toured around the UK. Laurel and Hardy, I would say, were some of the first comedians to really use audio effect and music to their advantage in the comedy world. From their 1937 Way Out West to their hilariously famous 1932 The Music Box skit, they always found a way to really bring out the slapstick humour in all their films. The Music Box is one of my favourite comedy films because the audio effects used for every silly action works, and combined with their witty dialogue, it's one of Hollywood's most recognised talky comedies. Another way that Laurel and Hardy had influenced the world of music and film is their signature intro, called The Cuckoo Song. This song was used by them as their intro to all their films, and the tone and overall sound of the song gives an almost comedic and happy feel, and this, I think, was essential, as it immediately tells the viewer that it's a comedy or something which is going to have a happy tone. I say this is influential mainly because it's one of the first uses of music to be used to portray a mood along with the previous talky films. Sound and music in film originally started out as live performances by orchestras, or sometimes an organist or a pianist, but these were never made for any specific film. They were just there for background noise, so that the room wasn't silent whilst watching the moving pictures. Like I've mentioned before, this all changed once Birth of a Nation was created, and the soundtrack that played was made for that film, and that film only. When the film industry was starting to grow more and much faster, people realised that being original was the key to being noticed, not only by the companies but also the public. Warner Bros. Made the Vitaphone in 1926, and it was the only sound on disc system which was used very widely and commercially. This system was helped by Lee DeForest's amplifier tube and Edward C. Wendt's condenser microphone, as they were brilliant advances, but nothing had been perfected until the Vitaphone. Using this technology, the famed film The Jazz Singer was able to be the first film to have synchronized dialogue and music. In 1931, a two-machine system was made by Western Electric, and it was developed from the RCA Photophone by Fox's Feature Films. The difference between a two-way system compared to a one-way system is that there was one lens would shoot the frames, and the other would be known as a sound camera, and it served as an optical recorder which was used to automatically lock in with the pictures. This meant that the pictures and sound could be recorded at the same time. However, Fox kept making newsreels with a single system camera, as they were easy to move around. For the next half a century, sound systems in cinema were licensed to either RCA or Western Electric. This continued until 1976, where optical sound recording had been converted to the Western Electric Stereo Variable Area System. And as digital sound became much more popular than optical sound, 35 and 70mm films have been using digital versions of the soundtrack on edges of the film strip, and this continued to stay the same. Most films are still processed with digital and analog soundtracks, and that means that they can be read by any projectors in any cinemas. There are many key composers of music throughout film, and these include Hans Zimmer, John Williams, and Bernard Herrmann. One important person from the 1940s is Bernard Herrmann, who worked on Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho, Vertigo, and North by Northwest. After working on music for 4 years, Bernard met Orson Welles and had the opportunity to conduct the live orchestra for Welles' famed The War of the Worlds in 1938. After Welles earned his RKO Pictures contract, he had Herrmann work for him, and he wrote his first film score for Citizen Kane. He received an Academy Award and nomination for Best Score of a Dramatic Picture. He then went on to make the scores for The Magnificent Ambersons, The Orson Welles Show, and The Hitchhiker, Ceiling Unlimited. Herrmann is the most associated with Alfred Hitchcock, as he created the famed musical scores of Psycho, which are very well known, especially the shower scene. Two other composers from recent history are John Williams and Hans Zimmer, as they have both aided music in film. Hans Zimmer started on the 1988 film Rain Man, and he was picked up by Barry Levinson, who was looking for someone to score Rain Man, and after being impressed by Zimmer's work, he'd noticed by more producers such as Ridley Scott and Walt Disney. He has famously worked on the scores for The Dark Knight and Pirates of the Caribbean movies. John Williams is a very significant composer as well, because he worked on well-known films such as Star Wars, Indiana Jones, E.T., Home Alone, Jurassic Park, and the first three Harry Potter movies. Williams' father was a jazz percussionist, meaning he was always in a musical family, and in 1952 he joined the US Air Force, which he would play the piano, brass instruments, and conducted music for the Air Force band. He left the Air Force in 1955 and moved to New York, where he studied with Rosina Levin. He played at many jazz clubs, and at the Eastman School of Music he worked with other composers such as Franz Waxman, Alfred Newman, and Bernard Herrmann. He was approached in 1974 by director Steven Spielberg about composing music for his debut The Sugarland Express, and later on his second debut film, Jaws. There are some basic techniques which need to be known if you're using sound in film. Diegetic sound is noise which is heard in the scene or the world of the film, like dialogue or sound effects. This is really effective at giving the film a sense of normality and makes everything seem real. Dialogue in film is essential, as it gives characters personality and it can help move the story forward with interesting events or plot twists. Dialogue, which is scripted, has to have a good delivery to sound natural, and there must be good vocabulary so the audience can understand what's going on. Non-diegetic sound is noise which isn't directly from the world or scene, and it's added in after production. This would include music or voiceovers. Music in a film is a great way to get your audience to feel a specific emotion or sensation which is portrayed in the scene. Music can also help if it's playing when a character is on screen, because this would give the audience a better understanding of what that character is feeling, or it could make the audience empathetic for that character. Music in a scene can make a difference, as it can either parallel or juxtapose with the scene. When music parallels with the scene, it is matching the feelings and events that are happening on screen. For example, a death scene of a light character, the music would be sad. The opposite of this is when music contrasts with the scene, and it's the opposite of what the emotions are on that screen. Lastly, a leitmotif is a film's or character's signature tune. An example of this could be the Jaws theme tune. Indiana Jones' theme tune. Or for a specific character, Norman Bates with his infamous Psycho violin tune. I've experimented with making my own sound for a scene in the film, and I'm using the technique of Foley. Foley is when you make or gather sounds which can be used after filming to make the scene feel more real. I've used a clip from Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark where Indy is trying to recover the Ark from a truck. Also, I have interviewed a professional which works in audio and sound, and I've asked him some questions about the history of sound and his opinions on some of the techniques. Apart from the jazz singer, what other talkies from the 1920s would you say gave an influence in the sound production of that era?
Alice Guy Blush. She used sound effects in all her films, and they predate the jazz singer.
Okay.
She was the first female film director. And she directed, I think she made well over 100 short films. They were all short films, of course, most of them. So yeah, Alice Guy Blush would use a audio track of sound effects and was hugely successful, in my opinion. Don Juan, starring John Barrymore, you must have heard of John Barrymore.
Yeah.
Classic silent film star. In the crossover between talkies and the silent era, Don Juan predated the jazz. Everyone thinks that the jazz singer was the first, but it really wasn't. It was the one that broke through and hit the national conscience in America, consciousness. It was kind of like Avatar, the equivalent of when Avatar came out.
Oh, right.
And 3D took off. But of course, 3D did not become a cultural thing, you know, it didn't change the industry fundamentally. And we could have told them that, really, because 3D never works.
No.
I have a saying, if I can't walk around it, it ain't 3D.
Yeah.
And that's it. Also, remember people like Frank Capra, who did It's a Wonderful Life? He was there at the crossover between silent and talkies. King Vidor was there between the crossover between the two. So I think King Vidor did a film called Hallelujah.
Okay.
In 1929, I think. And that had music and sound effects in it, and voices.
In conclusion, after all the research I've done, I found out a lot about the sound and audio side of the film industry, and it's really interesting to see the vast difference of how music was only used to cover the silence and cacophony of a projector. However, now it's much more about expressing feelings or a character's tone. The dialogue from character to character could reveal plot twists which changed the film's entire plot, or the sound effects edited in after filming can really bring out the silly in a slapstick comedy.
Hasta la vista, baby.